name is Michael Hochberg. I'm a research director with the French National Center of Research based in Montpellier, France, and I'm an external faculty member at SFI.
I'm Daniel Promislow. I'm a professor in the departments of biology and pathology at the University of Washington. There are a lot of researchers who study the biology of aging, some from an evolutionary perspective, some from a more molecular perspective or physiological perspective. They don't tend to go to the same meetings, and I think especially now there's a tremendous opportunity for the evolutionary perspective on aging, the ecological perspective, and the more molecular, biomedical, physiological approach to studying the biology of aging to come together and think about aging in a new way. And that was part of the motivation for putting this meeting together.
Right. So our original idea in motivating the meeting was to use our own backgrounds, which is in evolutionary biology of aging, and restrict ourselves, so to speak, to an evolutionary perspective of aging. And in discussing this with Daniel about a year ago, we thought, why not open this up to a larger perspective of having these different people, who most of whom we knew of but had never met before, come into the same room and bring their perspectives and confront one another with new ideas to try to push and stimulate new ways for each of us to think about aging.
I would add that Michael first contacted me with the idea of putting in a proposal as part of this Arrow of Time initiative. And I don't have any involvement with SFI, and so I really had no idea where this was going to lead, if anywhere. And so it's especially gratifying to me that we were not only successful in putting together a proposal that we felt good about, but also that we managed to bring all these people together from these different worlds.
Right. And with a lot of risk, because for me, out of the 15 people in the room, there were three who I knew personally and three or four others who I knew by name. And you just simply don't know, when you're in the same room for 2.5 days, what is going to come out. And the organizers hope and try to motivate the members of the group to contribute to the group ideas and interactions and want the group to be successful. And this can only be done in a process-wise manner. That is, as the days progress, we see how things are going and we try to adapt how these discussions are going so that we can go in a direction that makes everyone happy and fulfilled and learning. And we feel that we really succeed in doing that. We've known one another for over 20 years and occasionally meet up in departments or at conferences. And we've discussed research each time, but never concrete projects. And about 2 years ago, I believe I sent you a manuscript on naked mole rat aging. So Daniel provided great comments on the manuscript. And I think we stayed in contact after that manuscript and exchanged ideas about aging. And aging research is much more central to Daniel's research program than it is to mine. And so I proposed to Daniel, why not think about putting together a workshop or a working group at Santa Fe Institute to try to make progress on these problems from different perspectives. So that was the original impetus.
And having interacted with Michael over the years, I'm always really excited when I see people trying to work in an interdisciplinary way. I think that things are often really exciting at the interstices of different fields, and I've always known Michael to be someone who has a very integrative mind in pulling together ideas from lots of different areas. And so I was open to doing some work with Michael as soon as he proposed it, because I thought something interesting will happen. I don't know what it's going to be, but I'm pretty sure it'll be something interesting. From my perspective, I go to a lot of meetings on aging, and they're very molecular. There's a rich body of theory to try and understand the evolution of aging. And there's this big field of what we now might call molecular geroscience, using molecular biology to understand the basic biology of aging. Those two fields don't talk to each other. People say, wouldn't it be nice if they talked to each other? I think we're now at a place in terms of the technology that we bring to the biology of aging and the theory that there really is an opportunity to begin to bridge this these two worlds. And so for me, I think a real motivating factor was that we're kind of ready to bring these two groups into the same room. And if we can find people who are willing to open their minds to other ideas, we're now at a place where we can really begin to make some headway. So for example, I've spent many years going to meetings and sitting on grant review panels with people like Roz Anderson. Dario Valenzano comes out of that molecular training, although he thinks also like an evolutionary biologist. And then there are people like Ophélie Rance and Tulja, who have spent their careers developing mathematical models about populations. And trying to get the people who are thinking about the mathematical models and the evolutionary theory of aging to also think about all these molecular networks that are networks of molecules interacting with each other and changing over time. And can those two worlds come together? Is an open question. People have suggested that they should, but no one's really suggested that we try, I think, until Michael suggested it. Yeah.
So I come from a slightly different perspective, and having worked for a number of years on disease in general, and specifically on bacterial pathogens and on cancers, and one thing that we notice is that our susceptibility to many diseases increases with age. So the question is it just time that is involved? More time means more chances of getting diseases, or is it a convolution of time with actual aging? So it is getting more febrile and more susceptible to these different diseases. And together with that, looking at disease is not simply looking at a cancer cell or at a bacterial cell, but rather looking at where these things travel and how bodies deal with it. So it means looking at different scales, all the way from molecules that the body uses to try to fight infections and fight cancers, through to tissues, how tissues change when they're infected, through to organs, organ systems, regulatory systems, and therefore thinking about aging in each of those different levels from the standpoint of how natural selection, coming back to natural selection, has fashioned our bodies and fashioned populations to deal with these diseases, bacterial infections and cancers. And can we come up with some kind of framework or predictive theory that will be sufficiently general so that we get certain insights into understanding what is really going on in the aging process? And does it match the data? So one of the beauties of this working group is having several people that are really data-oriented scientists that were able to bring information into the discussions of real grounded data-based observations and insights that help the more theoretical people, one of whom is myself.
I think we had a really terrific diversity. And there's definitely overlap between the kinds of questions that Michael thinks about and the kinds of questions that I think about, but we also have these non-overlapping worlds. So, I think about basic geroscience, like hardcore molecular physiological geroscience, and people using comparative approaches to study the biology of aging, and epigenetics, cell biology, hardcore theory. So that's sort of some of the people from my experience who came.
Yeah, so disease biology, and that encompasses a large range of factors that correlate with aging. So it could be an intrinsic disease that involves the body and there's no etiological agent outside the body. Or diseases that are kind of halfway between infectious ones, such as from bacterial pathogens and cellular diseases, one of which is cancer, which in some respects resembles a parasite within the body. So bringing people with these kinds of perspectives, in particular James DeGregori, who's a cancer specialist and was able to bring beautiful data and also theoretical insights to the group.
And I was also, so I wasn't, I was aware of David Schneider's work, but haven't read his work recently, and I thought his work on networks, which is not about aging, had a lot of interesting kind of overlap with the things we're thinking about in aging. Someone else who came more from your world, who I thought really added some tremendous insight, was Martin, who brings an ecological perspective. And that was unexpected to me. I thought that was really terrific.
Yeah, so Martin Schaefer, in some respects, was an outlier, and other respects, the most central person to this question in the workshop. And I had met him at another working group here at SFI last summer and saw him give a talk, and he had one or two slides that really intersected with the kinds of things that Daniel and I were thinking of, but he's not working on biology in the sense of bodies and organisms and species. He's working on mostly on ecosystems and communities. So in some ways, he not only grounded the group in being probably the person who worked the closest on these paradigms of different levels and how that would affect the collapse of systems, what he calls tipping points and failure, but also he's this outlier who doesn't really work on organisms, he works on communities. So he was actually key to the discussions.
And then often at meetings on aging, we're focused on the basic biology of aging, and we don't think a lot about what happens to us as we age. And one of the nice things was at this meeting we also had a physician, Barb Natterson Horowitz, who has a deep understanding of what happens to the human body as it ages, but is putting that in an evolutionary context. And so it was a wonderfully diverse group. Yes.
My first response is to be seen. I think it's really this morning, the last day, that we feel that things came together and we were able to draw one diagram on a blackboard that integrated two plus days of discussion. So I think that the main insight is these different levels or the networks of interactions that are occurring throughout life and reflect and can be predictive of how processes and systems change and fail with age. So I think that's what comes out is the interdependence of these different parts of a network and the challenge of actually identifying what they are and how they interact, which is largely unknown. So we have lots of information on the different nodes in these networks and some of the possible interactions, but the actual dynamics are not that well known. So I think the real importance as we see it today on the final day of the workshop is the main question that it produces is, can we explain these dynamics?
And I agree, and we'll just add to that the framework, the visual framework that we drew this morning is not novel in itself, but I think we began to realize that this framework is partly about trying to tie together an evolutionary or ecological approach with a molecular approach, the proximate questions of what's going on, how is it that something falls apart, with the evolutionary questions of why these things fall apart. And one of the things that came out of this morning, I think, was a recognition that we can begin to take pieces of that, in some ways, overwhelmingly big question of can we bring together the evolutionary and molecular perspective, and we began to take pieces of it that actually are manageable, that suggest that yes, we can begin to work with that network as a kind of central locus through which we integrate evolutionary thinking and molecular thinking. I think what we have is a framework that allows a group of people like us, like the people who are in that room this morning, who are all willing to go beyond their own spheres of knowledge, to generate ideas and questions that they can then take to a molecular biologist. I don't think if we just show this framework with a paragraph describing it to a molecular biologist, they'll say, oh, I know what my next experiment should be now. But we can work with that to think through a set of experiments that might begin to allow someone to generate data that is working towards integrating these different areas within the context of these networks.
And this was a big point of discussion, actually, in each of the 3 days is the grounding of what we were talking about, observations and experiments. And the minimum thing that we, I think, established and are confident we can do is find some of the case studies that are the best study systems that give us some kind of basis for hypotheses that could be tested using experiments. Then the key is discovering what or determining what kinds of experimental systems are most amenable to these kinds of studies. And there were several people in the room that are particularly excited about this because they actually use model systems in their labs or in the field where perhaps some of these hypotheses could be tested.
So there are lots of people in the room, including myself, who are using, who are working with diverse systems, collecting high dimensional molecular data, which can be used to construct networks. So in my own work with fruit flies and with dogs, with pet dogs, we measure the metabolome, the microbiome, the transcriptome, and we can build these networks and ask how they change with time or how they differ between different, let's say, long-lived and short-lived genotypes. Someone like Dario Valenzano is doing that, but in a phylogenetic context. So he can look at networks, so the structure of networks in these very short-lived killifish that survive for just a few weeks, a few months, and then they die as the pond is drying up versus their fairly close relatives that can live for a much longer time. Roz Anderson is looking at metabolomic networks, so networks of metabolites in these metabolic pathways in these rhesus macaques that are under the caloric restriction regime where they live longer versus the control regime. So lots of different people doing that conceptually similar sorts of things in a variety of different contexts.
There are also systems that are much more challenging. So for example, Bernie Crespi brought some information on neural systems and the brain, and it's difficult to design experiments for obvious reasons on how the brain ages, and most of what we know is based upon observation and sampling. Same thing for the heart. So two of the critical organs in the body, the brain and the heart, are two of the most difficult to experimentally deal with in terms of testing theory. Barbara Natterson Horowitz, who was talking about heart function and different kinds of heart disease, and much of that is based upon sampling, but the sampling of individuals that have either died or have come into, for humans, come into hospital, one can't possibly imagine doing true experimental randomized studies on heart perturbations, unless they're very minor ones. So it's actually another aspect that we studied, that we discussed, is perturbations, small perturbations versus large changes resulting in failure. There's possibilities of perturbing the brain or perturbing aspects of heart function that could perhaps reveal something about an aging heart. How well does a heart react to a small perturbation as a function of age? So that's maybe one experimental inroad to testing some of these theories.
I want to sort of come back to something you were asking about and sort of a personal experience for me in working with Michael on developing the idea for this workshop that got me excited, you know, when he first talked to me about this notion of the arrow of time, and I started thinking about my own work and what the arrow of time means in a fruit fly or in a pet dog, for example. And as we worked together on this, we sort of came up with this framework where there are three different kinds of arrows, or three arrows in three different dimensions, that influence how an organism of any species functions. There's the arrow of time that's about function, like a heartbeat, for example, or the time that it takes for a nerve to fire, or the time that it takes to climb up a hill. These are sort of real-time physiological attributes. Then there's the arrow of time that's about failure. How long does it take for a cell to die, or how long does it take for an organism to die, a short-lived killifish or a long-lived tree? And then there's the arrow of time that's evolutionary time. How long does it take for these physiological functions to evolve? How long does it take for aging to evolve? How fast does it change as the environment changes and shapes the selective forces? So the arrow, from the perspective of an organism, the arrow of time, in a way, is three different orthogonal arrows.
So I think the arrow of time and aging at different scales, what are we actually looking at in terms of information, energy flows, flows of mass in a system, in case of our working group, biological systems. And that is, when we observe the pace of time and aging in molecules in a body versus cells in a tissue versus tissue structure, organs, organ systems, all within the same body, do we see parallel dynamics? Do we see different dynamics? And the question for us as evolution biologists is how evolution may or may not have, through natural selection, molded what we actually see in terms of these different aging rates of different tissues and different levels.
So for me, at a specific level, there are some things that I've been thinking a little bit about, like how do networks change over time, and discovered a group of people who are interested in that question from very different perspectives. And so I feel like there are new opportunities for collaboration that I'm excited about. So this morning we broke off into pairs, and it was kind of random. I ended up talking with the last person who didn't have a pair assigned, David, and we realized that we really are asking the same question, but from different directions, and he has data that he hadn't thought about analyzing in this way that I could analyze to ask these questions about how networks are changing over time. So for me, it wasn't so much a new question as discovering new people to work with and new ways to address that or answer that question.
So I think a lot of us had the similar experience, just the way we design without perhaps knowing the way these discussion periods worked, having groups of three, four, five people, and then this morning only two people, you get different kinds of dynamics just by adding or subtracting one or two people from a given group. So I had a similar experience this morning to Daniel and talking to Bernie Crespi, and we started talking about sleep and aging in sleep. And why is it that if you look at a baby, very young baby, weeks or a couple of months old, baby's going to sleep, waking up, going to sleep, waking up. Why is that? Why then do we go into phases of longer and longer periods of sleep, building up to 5, 6, 8 to 10 hours? And then it was as we age, typically we either require or at least get less sleep. So why? So Bernie and I started discussing this and thinking we're both going to be attending a meeting in Zurich this coming August. Let's keep this in mind and talk more about it and perhaps develop some kind of collaborative research project. I think the only new thing I would add to complex time from what I said in just before is really these different levels that we tend to associate with size, if nothing else. So going from molecules that we cannot possibly see with the naked eye to organisms, which is actually the level that we deal with on a day-to-day basis. So we never, or very rarely, see, and we shouldn't be seeing, insides of bodies, how organs are functioning, unless we go to a doctor. That's the only way that we get indication of the condition of our heart or the condition of our kidneys and so forth. And so I think the interest to me of the complex time is that these different levels of inquiry of structure could be aging in different ways, but in complementary ways, because they're all part of the same boat. They're all in the same boat together.
For me, the one of the exciting things that came out of this meeting, as Michael approached me to join with him and in thinking about complex time, was starting to think about the complexity of biological time in three independent or orthogonal dimensions, from the dimension of physiological function, from very quick things like an electrical impulse in a nerve cell, to slower things like heart rate or respiration, to even slower things like going on a long walk. So the physiological time, and then the failure time, which really was what we were talking about at this meeting, biological failure, aging, cell death, which is happening all the time in our bodies, to longer things like eventually aging and dying, from short-lived organisms to long-lived organisms, and this very long duration arrow of time of evolution, which has a shorter component, selection from generation to generation, but then also these long-term things. And thinking about failure, we can think about extinction of species happening over the course of millions of years. So I think of that one way to conceptualize complex time for a biological organism is with these three different related axes, each of which impinges on the other.
There's also an overarching aspect here, and this is actually something when Daniel and I started developing the proposal, we started by listing an outline of the different topics, and we had 10 or 15, 20 topics. It went all the way from cell biology to cosmology, right? Any kind of aging. So I think that the real holy grail here is biological aging. That's a big question, a big area. But how general is this, and is it within the framework of the arrow of time to other forms of aging? For example, and this came up again and again at our working group, and that is the aging of a car. The car is a system. Is the car an evolutionary entity? Yes or no? Some people were astounded by that proposal. Others totally, you know, took that on board. How do cultures age? How, if we go into the realm of physics, how does aging of physical entities occur? And are there common frameworks, a common framework that can explain, go from all the way from the biology to the cosmology, and lead to certain insights that will help us understand aging.